This right here is an AHM C-liner. Some of you may recall that this was featured in another video where I fixed it up and got it working as well as I could. So this is a model that was in production for a long time under the AHM name, made by Mahano. And it was popular because of its low price. And since there are so many of them out there, you can easily find these for a very low price. What a lot of you may not know, though, is that the C-Liner was originally developed in the early to mid 1950s by Rivarossi, and it was quite a different beast back then. The original Rivarossi model is also very rare and often goes for a very expensive price because of that. And to find one in mint condition, you may be looking to pay hundreds of dollars to get one for the few that are left in existence in that condition. After searching around for a while, I was actually able to find one of the original Rivarossi C-Liners in its original box, although it is built already. It is as close to all original as I think I'm ever going to find. And there it is right there, unpainted, just built to its basic level of assembly. And I think it's going to need some tune-up work because it's been sitting around for a very long time. So before I get around to doing that tune-up, let's just go over a little bit of history for this model, see where it started and where it ended up. Since I've already talked about the history of this model in my other C-Liner video, I'll try to keep this section more brief. In 1952, Rivarossi developed the first version of the C-Liner with a Bakelite body and an all-metal chassis, and this is available either as a kit or ready to run. A few years later, they changed to a styrene plastic body and a newer version of the motor, and shortly after that, they replaced the metal chassis with a plastic one. If you want to see this version more in depth, SMT Mainlines posted a few videos about it. A few years later, in the early 1960s, the tooling was licensed over to Mahano for production, and this was mostly the same as the Rivarossi version with just a few changes, such as to the motor. Over time, though, a few things were done to cheapen the model, such as changing the 5-pole motor to a 3-pole, removing the grab irons from the front, and changing the gears to all plastic eventually. Most of the C-Liners you'll see on the market are these cheaper versions. Then sometime later, either in the 80s or possibly the 90s, I'm not sure when, these were changed to have an 8-wheel drive chassis with a centrally mounted motor and better truck side frame detail. And these were sold by IHC. So, as I mentioned in that history portion, this original model here has their Bakelite body instead of the styrene plastic that was used for the vast majority of them starting in the late 50s. So you can see that there really is a difference in quality of the Bakelite. In certain areas, it's just not quite as smooth. Around here, it didn't pick up quite as much detail. And there's just really a different quality about it overall. They also had to make it really thick just to be able to hold up, and the material is harder and more brittle than styrene, so it's also not snapped in place like those bodies are, which usually had the, well, which always had the latches in these locations here. So in the case of this model, those are just details. The side frames are die-cast metal, as well as the entire mainframe of the truck, which has a brass bottom plate to it. There's a die-cast weight here. The front truck is also die-cast with a brass plate on the bottom. And the centers of the wheels are Bakelite with the tires pressed on around them, which I believe these are nickel-plated brass. Now the front here is a modification that was done by the original owner, who did not want it to be a truck-mounted coupler. So I don't exactly know what that piece is, but the coupler was screwed in place to it, and then that was supposed to be screwed into a little hole that was drilled there, which, there, now you can see it. So that hole is not original. I might try to fill it in, I might not, I'm not sure. We'll see. And last thing, the chassis itself is a solid brass plate. It is not plastic like all of the later ones. Oh yeah, and the back of it is also quite a bit different. It is just the simplest flat back that you can possibly get with nothing more than an outline for the back door. And then there's also this hole here, which it's covered by the weight, but I'm guessing maybe that was so that a wire could pass through for lighting up a dummy unit. Anyway, let's get into this thing and see what we've got. Start by removing the weight here, because you can see there are two screws underneath that help to hold the body on. One there and one there. And to get to those, I have to take off the weight. All right, there are those. Two screws in the middle. Two in the back. Then two more in the front. Now I should just be able to lift the body off from the chassis. There it goes. So there is the original Rivarossi C-Liner chassis. You can see here that the motor is a very, very different overall build than what they had later on. It's a Bakelite cover piece here, or Bakelite end cap with brush holders, so they're screwed in place. And then a steel piece wraps around as the main framework with the magnet, field magnet, mounted to the middle using a couple screws. It looks like they used two magnets in there. They must have just been able to use whatever they could get. And then two screws to hold it in place right there. So this motor is the same one that was used in the Hiawatha. They also had another 442 that used the same motor, and it may have even appeared in the early dockside steam engines. And they based this motor on the designs that were available from Trix. From some histories I read, Alessandro Rossi went over to Germany to check out some of the trains they had there and did a lot of examination and decided to base his motor off of the Trix design, and this here is the result. Let's see, is this wire soldered in place? No, it is not. Looks like it's just being held in by some pressure, so I'm gonna partially unscrew this brush cap here, pull that wire out, so that disconnects the motor. Also, you can see by the design of the end cap here, or that center end cap, that this one uses ball bearings. Now, as for getting this motor off, let's see. Actually, I think I should take the truck apart first to do that. And I might as well take these side frames off too. I'm gonna strip that paint off of them. It's not original anyway, so it's not like that's affecting the value at all. As delivered, these side frames were unpainted silver metal, just like the main frame of the truck. And there are your Bakelite wheel centers. Quite a bit shinier than what came later. And these wheels feel kind of stuck. I'm guessing it's because of some metal expansion that happened. These early Rivarossi metals did tend to have problems with the zinc rot, zinc pest. I see, so there are nuts there holding it in place. Maybe I can go ahead and take the motor off first. Feels like it's not really secure in there. Okay, that's interesting. Uh-huh. I think. Yeah, there it is. There's a set screw that holds the worm in place to the motor shaft. See if I can loosen that a touch. I don't know if that's loosening. Oh, maybe the motor will just come out. Let's see. I do wish I had the instruction manual on hand. Okay, that does not come out. Well, let's just get this bottom plate off of the truck. Maybe that'll tell me more what's going on. All right. So classic Rivarossi design in there. This is basically the same gear design that they use for the E8. So those lift out of there. This last one, held on by a screw right there. All metal gearing. Definitely not like the later C-liners. Now, about this worm. It looks like it does hold the motor in place, so I need to figure out how to get that off. It's very interesting. The screw just kind of goes through it. It looks like it doesn't actually tighten down onto the worm, so it can wiggle around a lot. I wonder if it's supposed to be like that. That screw is completely stuck in there. Okay, well, I wish I didn't have to do this, but it looks like I'm gonna have to drill it out. So I'm just lightly holding the armature of the motor to try and keep it from turning. I'll gently start going through there with the drill. Looks like I finally got that. Yes, it's drilled out. So now I can take this apart the rest of the way. There goes the motor. And then the truck has one more screw holding it on. So there's the main frame of the truck. And you can see some small hairline cracks around it, as well as the fact that it's not completely flat on the bottom there, so it definitely has seen some zinc rot, but it hasn't fallen apart, which means I can do some work to fix that up and get it just right. I do not know what that slot is for. Maybe that's a place where a wire could run along and be hidden underneath, or maybe that was the intention behind it, I don't know. Either way, here's the motor. And there's still some of that screw left inside, but now that the motor is free, I think I can get that out the rest of the way, and then I'll just replace it with a pin or something. Then the worm. I did kind of chew out around the edges there with the drill bit, so I can fix that, though. And as for the way that this is made, they did actually intend for it to be able to move around like that on the motor shaft, so that it can kind of wobble around independent of the motor, and then that is held in place by a bearing that's built into the bottom plate. So it turns in there just like that, and that's what keeps it centered in the truck and prevents the worm from wobbling. Let's see what we can do about the rest of this. And there are no traction tires on these old wheels. So nothing to clean up there. It is all metal. And they use their kind of standard metal backplate design to ground one wheel and leave the other insulated. Yeah, it's definitely not turning freely in there, so that is due to metal expansion. But since I can turn it a little bit, that means I won't have to file much away. Just a little bit on each side. Yeah, that's already much better. And there is a little bit of dirt and corrosion within the axles, so I'll also get those cleaned up so that they can turn freely. Then I can get things oiled, and it should work smooth as if it's brand new. That's looking pretty good now. And the gears turn a little bit stiff in there, but I can't exactly file out those slots. There is some back and forth play though, so that seems to be fine. Just trying to wear the parts into each other a little bit, see if that helps. I think a little oil will help too. Yeah, oil helps quite a bit. I think part of the problem is also just that these die-cast parts are extremely oxidized in and out. So I'm going to see if maybe I can remove the oxidation from this as well as that bit of paint. So I discovered a trick a little while ago that if you place an old oxidized piece of zinc or zinc casting into evaporust solution, then after a while it will actually take away the oxidation, leaving you with a bright, shiny, and clean part. So I'm just going to leave that in there for maybe a day, and we'll see how it looks afterward. Now, as for the brass pieces, I decided as long as I'm getting rid of the oxidation on the zinc, might as well use some Brasso and polish and get these shined up too to look as close to being factory original as possible. That's cleaning up pretty nicely so far. Now, taking a look at the motor, let's see, it goes this way, and I believe, well, let's see, which one is it? Yeah, it's this brush is positive for forward, and the other is negative. Let's see how that's running. Wow, that took right off, no problem. A little noise. That's a really nice running motor. Well balanced, smooth. Yeah, this does use ball bearings, so there's a little bit of noise from that. And of course, it's also really dry. Now, although ball bearings don't really need much oil, it's best to give them a little bit here and there. So let's see, I think I can add some by maybe, can I remove this? Okay. Turning gently. Okay. Little piece of that broke off, so I can't turn it with the screwdriver. So it's probably best if I leave that alone. I'll still try and add some oil where I can, though. Drop in here. That already helped. I do want to try and retighten this screw a little bit. Use the serrated pliers. This screw on the end, it actually helps to adjust the whole ball bearing system to work as perfectly as possible. Really, the only problem is with it is that they used a very small screw there. Yeah, that feels just right now. There's almost zero play in that motor. almost. Just a little more. Well, seems like I can't really get it much better than that. However, I might be able to find another way to get some oil in there. Let's see. Yeah, the spring is inside of there. And this is one of those little wire weave brushes. Which means the other one should be carbon if it's like their other motors. Or maybe not. They're both the wire type. Well, since this motor is made with ball bearings and those are extremely difficult to deal with when you're pulling one of these motors apart, I think I'm just going to leave this upper area alone because I don't want to get oil on the Bakelite piece either. So I'll just put it back together. I think it'll be fine as it is. And tightening these, you don't want to overdo it because, again, Bakelite end cap, it's brittle. If you turn too hard, you can crack it. So just snug is all you want to do with parts like these. It is quieter though with that oil in the lower bearing. That's pretty good low speed control too. They have a good magnetic field in here. So I'll just set that aside and put that back together later. Now as for the front truck, let's see. Looks like there's just a screw in here. Yeah. So aside from the fact that this is metal, there's almost zero design change between this and the later plastic C-liner trucks. That comes off. You have insulating washers. And it looks like that is also sprung. There. And like the other truck, the oxidation from the zinc is leaving marks on the brass pieces. So I'll get this all taken apart and cleaned up, just like the rear. There. And that is the full disassembly of the chassis. I'm also going to polish this piece up with some Brasso. As long as I've got it apart, here's the inside of the body. So you can see they've got screw posts with some brass inserts melted directly into the Bakelite. So that's what allows you to screw the body in. It makes it nice and strong and keeps you from accidentally damaging or stripping out the holes. You can also see right there where a bit of metal can be removed in order to feed a wire through and light up a dummy unit behind it. Alright, so after maybe 2/3 of a day in the solution and then a quick cleaning with some soft scrub, I think you can see just how much of a difference that evaporust can make on an old zinc die-cast part. So I'm going to do the same for this one, as well as any other die-cast pieces, and get them looking as good as they can. Now looking at the wheels, you can see that there is very, very little wear or even any signs of use on the treads. So that and the fact that there was absolutely no oil or grease in the gearbox would tell me that this model was never actually run. It was just put together and then thrown right back into the box. So I'll just wipe that off a little bit with the paper towel. And there's really nothing to do besides that with the wheels. So I can just start dropping things back in there and see about getting the powered truck back together. And as I put each part back in, I'll also add a little bit of oil to make sure it turns nice and freely. Before I get this all the way back together, one thing I just remembered is that the bottom plate was not sitting quite flat on there because of the metal kind of warping. So I'm going to file these ends down real quick to make sure that has a nice flat fit. So I'll just use the file across both sides to make sure that it's kept as even as possible. It might not be 100% perfect, but that's a lot better. So I think I can work with that. But so far, these gears all work extremely smoothly. They're very high quality parts. Now this gear needs to be screwed in. That should continue to work more smoothly as the model is run. Yeah, no binding at all in there. That's a good gearbox. If there's one thing you never want to do, it's run a model with all metal gearing without grease. Because those gear teeth will wear each other out very quickly otherwise. Now the front axle actually has to be greased all the way around, because it doesn't engage with the worm and it's exactly the same size as the idler gear. So if you only get grease in one spot, it's unlikely to move beyond that spot, at least for a very long time. So you spread the grease all around. Everything will work better and be coated much more evenly. Just to do some tests, I'm putting the bottom plate on without the worm to start. So now I can just kind of roll it around and make sure there aren't any binds that I need to work out. Okay, so far so good. Everything feels nice and smooth, rolls along with just a touch. Alright, so I did a little repair on the worm. I drilled out the rest of that hole in the motor shaft so that I can stick a piece of wire through, and then I fixed the worm by using a piece of brass tubing by soldering that in and just kind of grinding the sides down smooth again, and then drilled the inside out so that it could fit correctly to the motor shaft, and I think this is going to work. So I went over the whole chassis piece with some Brasso just to get that shined up a little. Of course, there's some much deeper tarnish, especially where it was handled previously, but I'm not really going to worry about that. I just wanted to get some of the main stuff off of there. So now getting the truck on. Start with that screw there, then the motor helps to hold it in place there, and it gets two screws of its own, these short brass ones. It's a little tricky to get that second one lined up. There, once it goes in, holds nice and tight. Okay, the truck is in place, so before I put the worm on though, I should put just a touch of oil in that spot. Make sure everything is going to work as smoothly as it can. Alright, so now, yeah, I've got the hole lined up, so I just need to push this down. And then I cut this little piece of brass wire to the length I need, and I squeeze the end to a sort of square shape so that I can press it in. I just insert it through here. Hopefully it'll go through everything. Okay, seems to be working so far. Okay, that's pressed in. Feels kind of tight, so I might have to push that back out and make some little readjustments. The motor seems to be turning pretty freely, so it might be all right. So in that case, I'll go ahead and add the last bit of oil and grease. Screw that back together and see how it works. All right, I've got that back on now. So I'll just hook up the clips here. See if it works. It's hard to keep these in place. Try attaching it there. It's working, but it's a little rough. So I might need to drill out that brass tubing a little. All right, let's try this again. Okay, that's a lot better. So there does have to be just a little bit of slop in how the worm is attached to the motor. It seems to be working well. It only grinds when it kind of pulls on it or goes out of place, but as long as it's sitting level and kind of within your normal running tolerance, should be perfectly smooth. And one little issue here is that it's running backwards from normal. But looking at how this is all put together, it looks like there's not really a good way to reverse that because you can't switch the sides of the gears. So one possibility might be to switch these metal plates over to the other side to contact those wheels instead. That might work, but I'll look more into it and figure out what I want to do for sure. All right, so I have the front truck back on there now, and while I was putting it together, I realized that the screw here didn't have any insulation from the chassis, so if it were to accidentally move around this way a little, it could have caused a short circuit with the rear truck, so I added a KD red washer as well as a bit of insulation to the screw, so that'll help there. And as for the electrical pickup, I think the easiest way to do this is going to be to swap the grounded wheel over to the other side. So I'm just going to take these back out from the rear truck and use my Northwest short line puller to gently remove them and transfer them over. Okay, looks like these are coming off without any damage, so that's good. So now the grounded wheel will be on the same side as the gear. Alright, so now I just need to put this over here. Make sure the larger side is facing out towards the flange. Okay, truck's back together. So both of the grounded wheels are on the right, and the front truck has them on the left. So now I'll just reconnect that wire. And I might as well just attach it how it was before. So unscrew this brush cap a little. And then stick it underneath here. There we go, that's holding on now. So I'm gonna reattach the weight here real quick too. Okay, I've got a piece of track here. So let's put this down and see if this works. Seems like there's a short circuit somewhere. And let's see what's going on. Oh, you know what? I think I got the wire a little too far over. Okay, I think I did just have to adjust that wire there, so give that another try. And there it goes. And for all I know, this might be one of the very first times it's ever run under its own power. That seems really good so far, too. Let's drop the shell on real quick. See how that is. Yeah, that seems to be working really well. The motor acts like it's got a flywheel of its own. It's a really free-turning motor. Speed control's not bad either. This really is a lot different from the later AHM ones. Okay, well, with that all working, I'll just get on to cleaning up those side frames and getting this put together. Side frames are cleaned up as well as they're ever going to be now, so I'll put them back on. That's just one screw each. You can see up close here that there are a lot of hairline fractures around these die-cast parts just because of that little bit of metal contamination at the factory, so it's actually pretty amazing that these haven't fallen apart, so I don't think they're going to decay any more than this, but I'm still going to be gentle with them just to be sure. Well, I'll worry about couplers later, but for now, there's the completed original Rivarossi C-Liner chassis. Now I think it's time to get the shell back on and give this some actual track testing. Also, I found out that the weight was not glued in, it just slots into the molding, and it must have been inserted really tight, because while I was checking things out before, it just kind of fell out. Also, I got the shell cleaned up, so it's nice and shiny, brand new looking again. So, let's just get this back together. Chassis drops into here. And I just have to put the six screws in to get it in place. This does seem a little bit picky about the screw alignment, so I'm leaving them all just slightly loose until I have every screw at least partially in place. So that way I can get them tightened evenly. Okay, shell is on. So now it just needs the fuel tank. Alright, now let's get this onto the track and see how it does. Before I can run it, I did notice that this side frame here has warped inward and is touching and shorting against this wheel. It's also creating a lot of resistance there, so let's see if I can do anything about that. Maybe if I just tighten it so it's not perfectly straight. Okay, that seems to be free now. Just have the side frame at a slight angle back. I think that's about the best I can do, really. Just considering how fragile these likely are, I don't want to try and bend it straight and then break it by a mistake. All right, the C-Liner's first time on a layout in probably 70 years. if it's ever even been on a layout. Definitely not a silent runner, not that I expected it to be. It's honestly working really well. It's just a little bit of wobble to get out of there. I might be able to do that just with some wheel counterbalancing. Yeah, that's honestly doing really well. It's only drawn about 0.2, 0.22 amps. See if that can go up to full speed. It's gonna be fast. There's 12 volts. It still only draws about a quarter of an amp at that speed. And then slow operation. Not too bad. So yeah, with a bit of runtime on it, I think this will end up being an even better runner than it already is. Now, as for the next thing I want to do, well, there's of course the couplers, but this kit also included brass wire to make full handrails all around, and then there should also be details here, the horn and then the vent. All of those were missing from this model, unfortunately, but I think I can replicate them. I've been working on the details. I drilled out all of the points for the handrails using a number 75 bit to use 0.02 inch brass wire. I don't know if that's the size that Rivarossi actually included, but I'm guessing that's at least close. And I've gotten that done for the front as well as the right side here. I think it's turning out well. I'm not doing that sort of complicated bend that Rivarossi did on the ready-to-run models. I tried, but it wasn't turning out well, so I'm just going with the standard 90 degree bend there. It's looking fine. I also managed to replicate the horn, base that on the AHM C-liner, and then printed it in resin. And then I mixed a touch of brown paint with black to replicate the color of the Bakelite as closely as possible. And I also filled in the hole down here that had been drilled for a front dummy coupler, sanded it a little bit. I didn't get it quite perfect, but it's at least filled in now, and I touched that up with the same blended paint. I think that's turning out well. So just have those last few handrails to do, and then I have to figure out how to finish this roof vent piece. Okay, the rest of the railings are finished, and I also put a rear coupler on. It's a Katie with one of their small space boxes, which are a little complicated to put together, but work fine once you do that. And I think it's close to the right height too, so that should be good. For the roof vent, I just made that out of a piece of plastic and painted it silver. I may eventually replace that with a more proper turned zinc piece to look as close as possible to the original. And then as for the front coupler, I'm likely not going to put that in at all just because this slot is too thin for a Katie to work. So it really was designed just for that hook system that this originally came with. So unless I can find one of those, I don't think there's going to be a front coupler at all for this engine, but that's just fine for me as long as it can pull something. And with that, I'd say all the work that I want to do on this is finished. There it is, all finished on the layout. And as for a review of this one, I thought it might be fun to compare it to the later AHM model, as well as the Proto 1000 C-liner that came almost 50 years later.
So starting off with the comparison, I think we can move on to the front where most of the differences are. Now you would think that the plastic shell would have been based directly on the original Bakelite shell here, but there are actually quite a few differences. You'll notice right away, I think, that the windshield on the original Bakelite shell is much more realistic in shape and scaling, being pretty comparable to the Proto 1000 windshield, where the plastic shells that came later on the AHM and some of the other Rivarossis from the late 50s were much larger and open and didn't look quite right. On both the AHM and Rivarossi, you'll very easily see that the noses are completely rounded off instead of coming to that slight point, like is correctly done on the Proto 1000. Now looking at the front pilots, I used to think that this hood here was completely unrealistic, but as it turns out, it does have a base in reality. You'll see in the photos here that some of the early C-liners actually had a sort of clamshell cover that would fit over the front coupler. Now most C-liners did not have that, so the Proto 1000 pilot looks more realistic for most, but at least the Rivarossi pilot isn't completely unrealistic. Also, you'll notice that on both the Rivarossi and AHM, there's a sort of band that goes around the front that has a bunch of rivets in it. But after looking through a bunch of photos, as well as comparing to the Proto 1000, it looks like that riveted band was never actually there. Now moving on to the front of the cab, you'll see that this is mostly smooth, but it has just a little molding seam right here. On the Proto 1000 C-Liner, that is completely smooth, and it also looks that way on the prototypes for all the photos I've seen. But on the plastic shell here for the AHM model, you'll notice that they actually added an extra bit of rivet detailing around here, which is not prototypical as far as I can find. So I'm thinking they may have just put that in there to try and cover up the fact that there was a big molding seam. Also, one of the most obvious things you might notice is that the Proto 1000, it correctly has the ladder here, but because of the oversized trucks on the Rivarossi and AHM models, the ladders were removed and were never present on any of them. Now looking at the top here, you have this ventilation on each side. Same for the AHM, looks almost identical. The molding on the AHM, I would say, is a little bit better, a little bit cleaner. Both of them, though, have their central vent completely closed off. It's just a disc on the top of there, and my guess is it's because this was developed in the early 50s in Italy at a time not long after World War II, so they may have been working using photos instead of actual blueprints. On the Proto 1000 model, that is correctly made with the sort of fan detail visible inside, and the mesh is much finer on the molded details, so that looks a lot better there. And now just for a clear view of the side, you can see some of the other obvious differences, like in the quality of the ventilation work here on the sides for both the Rivarossi and AHM. I would say that it was improved on the plastic shell over the original Bakelite, where some of the details are a little bit out of place and just don't look like they were molded quite right. On the Proto 1000 model, that's of course a lot cleaner and more realistic looking, with some variation in the ventilation designs where it's all just kind of a single slab across for both of these. And of course, one of the other major differences is in the truck side frame design. So on the original metal ones, they did at least get the bearings mostly aligned with the wheels, where on the AHM, you can see that that is just way, way out of place. It really doesn't line up at all with the wheels, so that looks just odd. Then as for the scaling of the details, the Rivarossi is the, I'd say, chunkiest, most oversized, especially in areas like the air brake tanks here, as well as the springs, and just the shape and overall detail of the bearing caps. It's all just way oversized, not very finely cast. And then, of course, just the overall shape of them. It almost looks like the proper FM side frames, but not quite. It's missing this curve at the bottom, And there are just other parts of the shape that really don't match up at all to how they should actually look. And now getting onto the back, the Bakelite shell is just a slab with a little outline, and there is no actual detail at all, so there's really nothing at all to see there. They improved that a lot with the plastic styrene shell, even adding in just these little MU cable receptacles and all those other details. So that was a major improvement in that area. Of course, Proto 1000 looks best, but the AHM shell at least looks good in that regard. And then this little opening here, I found that it is a place where you can run a wire from the A unit to a B unit, which gives you some extra electrical pickup. And if it's an AA setup, then I think that would also help with powering a light bulb on the dummy A unit. Then, of course, the rear roof ventilation. When you put the Rivarossi AHM next to the Proto 1000, you can see just how far off they got it. The scaling, the shape, the locations, all of them are really very wrong and out of place. And at least the detail is there, unlike this flat slab in the back. But yeah, when you put it next to a correctly scaled model, it definitely looks just way off. Now looking at the weight of each model, the Rivarossi one weighs in at about 18.5 ounces. So that really is a nice amount of weight there from the brass frame, the all metal trucks, the two extra weights in there, all metal motor, and then just the really thick Bakelite plastic used for the shell. The AHM model comes in at 13.8 ounces. So that's quite the reduction in weight, and they made up for that by using traction tires. And the Proto 1000 model weighs in at 19.3 ounces, so it is only slightly heavier than the original Rivarossi C-LINER. And now for comparing the running quality, I'll start with the Rivarossi. So it takes just about 2 volts to start. Not bad. And of course, like you saw before during the whole tune-up and restoration, it is not a quiet runner. It also has a pretty high top speed. I've clocked that in at 120 scale miles per hour. I'm running at a more realistic speed. That's about 7.5 volts there. It only draws about 0.25 amp, so it's honestly a pretty efficient runner for its day. It's got a little wobble there. Not much you can do about that aside from maybe filling in the center holes on each wheel and then re-drilling them using a lathe. Overall, it's not a bad runner for being Rivarossi's first attempt at an American diesel. All right, now moving on to the AHM. This is kind of a mid-production model with a 3-pole motor, all plastic gearing, and the earlier versions from them had a 5-pole motor, as well as a combination of plastic and metal gears, as well as a metal inner frame to the truck, much more like the late 50s Rivarossi production. Yeah, that took a few volts to get that started. Sometimes it'll start at about 2.5 volts. Get that up to full speed. It's using about 0.6, 0.65 amps on average. Sometimes that jumps up a little bit though. The running quality is not exactly consistent. In fact, it's struggling quite a bit there. When it's running properly, it gets up to about 120, 125 scale miles per hour. Low speed control, it isn't too bad. Not exactly the most consistent, but it is all right. But these are definitely cheap models. Now for the Proto 1000, and I think you all know already which one's going to be the winner in a performance comparison.
That only takes, well, it takes about 3.5 volts to start. So it's a higher starting voltage than the other two, but it is also much, much smoother, quieter. Really just better overall at all parts of its running quality. It's full speed there, and I've measured that to be 70 scale miles per hour. This uses the Athern clone trucks, which are smooth running, but also known to get split axles now and then, but those can be easily replaced with Athern gears. So it's easy to keep these going. And of the three models, this is the only one that is all-wheel drive and all-wheel electrical pickup, so it's going to be the most reliable on all track, as well as have the best axle traction with no dependence on tires. Low speed control, much smoother, much more steady. These are very well-built, well-designed models. So to conclude the review of the Rivarossi C-Liner, I'd say it's an overall good first attempt on their part for making an American diesel. There are definitely some inaccuracies to it, but considering that this is one of the pioneers of plastic diesels in HO scale, I think some of that can be forgiven in that regard. Of course, the chassis, with it being all metal, it has a good amount of weight, decent amount of pulling power for a four-wheel drive system. The only problem there is the occasional zinc rot that some of them had, but as long as the trucks haven't been destroyed by that, and combined with the ball bearing motor and the metal gearing, it should be a reliable runner as long as it's well maintained. Now, of course, as for the value of the model, because of the rarity of these, they're going to be expensive in almost all cases, so I definitely would not recommend getting one unless you're a collector who's willing to pay the price to get one, because it's really not a good value at all. Especially when you compare it to the Proto 1000 model, which you can find for definitely a lower cost than your average Bakelite original Rivarossi. And with that, you're getting a better shell, better chassis, and really better everything all around. So for the scale model railroad, definitely, definitely go for the Proto 1000. But if you're a collector looking to have some history in your model train collection, I think the Rivarossi C-Liner is worth looking out for.